we investigated and we began to grow ourselves too.
I don't want to see no fucking kid walking down the street with no fucking shoes on, man. I mean, he got a rip on his shirt, man. That makes me mad. That's pretty hard.
We didn't have no means of communication.
I don't know why it's so difficult for them to listen.
So I just said, well, that's not fair.
The first major wave of Samoan immigration to America began when the U.S. Navy left American Samoa in 1951. The second wave occurred during the early 1960s, reuniting families and possible better living conditions. There are about 100,000 Samoans on the West Coast and in Hawaii. Half are in Southern California. The Samoan island chain is divided in two. Western Samoa is an independent nation and American Samoa is a territory of the U.S. This tape is about OMAI FA'ATASI, a Samoan self-help organization based in Carson, California, which evolved from the socially turbulent years of the 60s. It shows how they work with the street youth of their complex community.
The idea was in the air around the late 60s.
We felt we needed to have some kind of organization that said, hey, we're Samoan.
OMAI FA'ATASI means come together. Means unite, means struggle for human dignity, those kind of things. Struggle to survive in this type of system.
It was pretty hard.
It was?
Yeah, really was. It was because I couldn't speak English. You know, I mean, could, but not as fast.
When I first came from Hawaii, I came here, they gave me some dirty looks.
I was born in Samoa, American Samoa, in the village called Pango Pango.
Well, I don't know nothing about Samoa because I never been down there.
Samoan kids who were born over here, well, they're different. You know, when they don't know how to speak their own language, the Samoan.
Samoans, they're starting to fall apart, you know. They don't, you know, speak that much Samoans no more. You know, they're trying to be like white men. But Forrest say, you know, you Samoans, you act like white to me, you know, you still a Samoan. You gotta be proud, you know. It's all right, you know, listen to black music. But one thing, you know, don't forget about, like, you're a Samoan, you're a brother, you know.
Here in the village mayor is directed by the high chief to call the village council to a meeting. It is proper and traditionally for a council meeting is always done with a cover ceremony.
Ready to receive the cards.
Traditionally, the highest chief drinks first. And you notice the server raised the cup up to the level of the forehead. It signifies a high chief is receiving the cup and also served with the palm of the hand.
In terms of identity, we even had to go back ourselves and study history, our history, because we wanted to know. And that meant going into books, researches, trying to get a hold of anybody anywhere. As we investigated, and we began to grow ourselves too.
For centuries, Samoa was a self-sufficient agrarian society. It was based on the communal clan system headed by the Matayo, the chief. They valued humanistic approach to life rather than material prosperity. But a Dutchman by the name of Jacob Rokenveen claimed the discovery of Samoa in 1722. Then missionaries followed in 1830, and traders from Germany, Great Britain, and America came in search of raw materials and overseas markets. Samoan society was disrupted. America was eyeing Pangopango for its safe and strategic harbor. Germany took an economic interest, importing people from Melanesia and China, since Samoans had no intention of working for somebody else. Samoa had become strategically important by the 1880s, which led to quarreling among the three big powers for territorial rights. Later, they were ready to go to war with each other when a hurricane came suddenly and destroyed the warships. Which resulted in the decision to partition Samoa. Britain, having problems with a war in South Africa, conceded any claims, while Germany possessed the islands lying to the west. America got those islands lying to the east. On April 17, 1900, Eastern Samoa became American Samoa, which is annually celebrated as Flag Day. As colonies of Western powers, Fa'asamoa, or the Samoan way of life, began to suffer change. Taxes were being levied. Samoans no longer ruled themselves. Individuals as well as organizations such as the Mau, with their motto Samoa Mo Samoa, or Samoa for the Samoan, began organizing and protesting all over Samoa. This movement eventually led to Western Samoa freeing its colonial bondage and becoming an independent nation in 1961. Meanwhile, in American Samoa, the outbreak of World War II led many Samoans to join the U.S. military to defend their islands. This group became the Samoan Fita Fita Guards. In 1951, the U.S. Navy pulled its fleet to Hawaii, thus creating the first major immigration wave to the United States.
I walked in the house and I told my mom that I had this job, found this job, they might hire me, and then she said that that she don't want me to work, she wanted me to go join the service. And I said, why do you want me to join the service? And she said, because that's the best thing for you right now. She thinks that I'll be just hanging around with all these guys out here, and she don't want me to hang around on the streets too much. She said, join the service. I told her, gotta go to school.
I really didn't make it in school, really didn't. Only when I was little, that was like in the second grade and the third. And then in the fourth grade, that's when I started, you know, really messing up in school. And from then on till now, I started getting into the dope. And, you know, I was, getting high mostly every day, and I just, it was relaxed, you know. I didn't want to go to school, and when I'd go back to school, I'd hear the teachers, you know, just getting on my back, and I didn't want that. So I never bothered to go, and then I had problems at home.
Samoan parents are very strict.
They're very religious, and they're strict.
Today versus then, you never hardly saw any sisters because of the strictness, okay? The girls never went anywhere or couldn't go anywhere. Now you see them all the time. Either they're running away or whatever.
I wish my kids grow up and, you know, be religious people, you know, and understand the Samoan way and help the Samoan people. And I want them to know and understand the language. Because I told them, I said, see, you a Samoan. No matter where you, you know, over here in the United States, but you a Samoan. I don't know why it's so difficult for them to listen, and you know, it seems like you love somebody and don't even care to you. Some people, they said, you don't have to worry because the kids, they really love you. I said, when? He said, when? What day are they going to?
They think they're boys and they don't have to do nothing. They think the girls are supposed to do everything.
Yeah, you know.
That's how Samoans are. They think that
girls, yeah, the girls stay at home. And the boys go out whenever they come home, whenever they
come
want
over
to.
Come home at 2 o'clock in the morning.
What time do you guys have to?
We can't go out.
Women stay home and do this work and that kind of thing. Whereas it's not so strict on the men or the boys. We found that's expected of them, I guess. He could go out and stay out all night. It isn't a big deal, okay? And if it was a girl kind of thing, it is a big deal. But you get probably killed.
So I just said, well, that's not fair if you treat the boys different than we are. It's because the girls, it doesn't mean the girls are weak, right? They're trying to say, like, you know, the hillside girl, stranglers.
Yeah.
You know, they can get raped easily.
Boys get raped, too.
They say that one of these days, one of the girls going to come with a big stomach.
Yeah, she'll become pregnant. And, you know, rape. But see, boys get raped, too.
But they don't get pregnant.
No, they go get someone. They go get someone.
But they get raped, too. They fight with knives and all that. They can get killed out the street too.
Lots of times, people are afraid of us just because we're physically large.
The only kind of publicity we would get would be negative publicity, except for maybe football. Another stereotype was dancers. You know, everybody's a dancer, you know. So anytime you need a dancer, you just call us Samoan, you know, and do a dance for you. You know?
A word gets around the community about Samoans getting into a fight and beating somebody up. It's very one-sided, like we're the bad dudes in town. This kind of stereotype made it hard for us to stay in school, find jobs, and deal with our elders. They didn't want no troublemakers. It got to the point where some Samoans would think they were white or black and didn't want to be Samoan, because outsiders only saw us through these stereotypes that they had in their head.
Ah!
lot of us that started the organization, we all had very similar experiences. The kind of lifestyle that we went through as kids, seeing all these things that we had to go through just to try to get a job or something like that, you know, to live. You know, we sort of like, we wanted to struggle so things could be better for the next generation. I think during the time that while we were all growing up, there wasn't that many Samoans in the area. You know, there was a few of us. Naturally, we had to stick together, you know, as a way of us defending ourselves from, you know, there was a lot of gangs and things like that going on. Defending ourselves from just the everyday harassment of the police, or just trying to make it and, you know, going through school. Some were lucky enough to finish school, you know, and some of us were, you know, just got kicked out of school or just gave up, you know. At the same time, too, we began to see a lot of the other minority groups struggling for their rights. Mm-hmm. I think, you know, around that kind of thing has given us one of our strongest points in getting together and organizing. Mm-hmm. We put out some history classes and that kind of stuff, and trying to get the young people and learning or knowing more about their history.
Just after dawning up here, the capital of Western Samoa, a welcoming party was planned for A.G. Smith, who was coming home after a two-year banishment. Smith had supported the Mau, a Samoan colonial opposition organization. The Mau movement demanded that this New Zealand island colony be returned to the Samoans and united around the cry, Samoa, Mo, Samoa. While the cheering crowd waited in peaceful anticipation, four high chiefs, including Tupuatan Sese, the leader of the Mau and the most respected of the Samoan leaders, joined the procession. Mau followers are identified by their blue lavalavas. The high chief's position is easily recognized by their dark coats. As the march moved toward the beach at Apia, the New Zealand police surprised the procession and arrested the secretary of the Mau movement. He resisted and attempted to escape. The remaining force of New Zealand were in hidden areas along the parade route. Tomsese stood facing the scene with the other chiefs, calling for order. The people began obeying the commands of their trusted leader. In the confusion, 11 Samoans holding high Matai titles were killed.
Saungi mai ka kau pengah.
Lalu lalu saungi aku perlu lepo vai.
Saungi ma. Saungi mai lah.
Kau efek shock kita awam.
Awang ni isi sih saung. Efek shock you ma. Shock you ma.
Sungguh lah.
Oi lalu ni mai lah ngah. Kau mai ufiak kau aku tu mai. Cina lalu wale lelong
ngah. All over Western Samoa and parts of American Samoa, meetings were held to discuss the problems of colonization and the need for self-determination. Before Tomasese died, he uttered his last wish to the Samoan people.
Oh, Samoan church has taken on a more responsible role in America, creating a new form of village gathering, but it left some gaps among the street youth.
As far as our people, we didn't have no means of communication, so I think that prompted us to try and get a newsletter together.
We set up our own programs to meet the needs in the community, such as health fairs, food co-ops, summer day camp, drug abuse presentations, and history class. We even set up continuation high school for kids who couldn't adjust to a traditional school setting. We also had fundraisers like dances and car washes to help pay for some of the programs and to create unity among the youth.
Oh, don't mind.
Yeah. You like it?
Oh, man, we've been through a lot, man. We went to courts, went to a lot of rallies, with protesting and shit, you know. Did a lot of things for people, like medical things were like with people that don't have any kind of finance, they could come to us, man. Like, we take care of the paperwork and like set them up, you know. I'm all for that, man, you know. I mean, as long as the kids are cool, man, it's all right with me. I mean, I don't want to see no fucking kid walking down the street with no fucking shoes on, man. I mean, he got a rip on his shirt, man, that makes me mad. I mean, I mean, kids are, I mean, like, they should have fun and shit, you know? I mean, they shouldn't be out there, eating shit. It ain't for them, man.
I haven't been, you know, involved with OMAI FA'TASI for a couple of years now. And all I know that is that they do have the school, the high school, training there for Samoan youths that have either dropped out of high school or can't, you know, was kicked out or whatever, you know, whatever kind of problems they had in high school. I know that they take care of that, and I think that's a good thing, you know. I think that's great.
For this OMAI FA'TASI, it's a pretty thing, you know, for the younger generation. Mainly because it keeps the people off the streets. It benefits the people, you know, on the long run. And it educates them, you know, helps them. And the kids have a place to go, you know.
Yeah.
You finished. Can we get a vote? Bye.
Over the last few years, we've seen some of the fruits of our collective labor in OMAI FA'ATASI. Many of the kids that went through our programs are off the streets and are into something positive, like wanting to strive for higher skills and better jobs. Others have gotten married and have taken on family responsibilities, like helping their younger brothers and sisters cope with the same problems we went through. When we see this, it makes us feel pretty good. But then again, because we are still growing ourselves and changing as we learned our history and worked with our community, everything was a trial and error. We made mistakes that we learned from, and we can only get stronger in this process. But not everything has been easy, though. Like, since the closing of our center due to Proposition 13, we can't keep a daily communication of what's going down with our youth like we did before. Over 45 kids have been arrested and booked for such charges as assault, burglaries, and even a murder. Plus, we face new issues where chances for us getting higher education and better jobs are taken away by the Baki case and Proposition 13 cutbacks. We need to have a more accurate account for the 1980 census to figure out a more responsive programs to deal with the basic needs for the Samoan community, so as to avoid such outrageous treatment, such as the one Samoan social worker for 60,000 Samoans. If we don't, some people will take this to the streets, like in the 60s.
We learned that nobody ruled us, we ruled ourselves.
Yeah.
That means come together.
Come all together. Togetherness.